Welcome to the knowledge series. Here under the course EC407, Computer Communication, we are going to discuss the area on congestion control. Congestion control refers to the mechanisms and technique used to control congestions and keep the traffic below the capacity of the network. This we have gone through my previous video series with respect to the congestions. As I have mentioned that when the load of the network is greater than the capacity of the network, then these particular congestions take place. So if you try to see in this particular slide, congestions is a situation in communication network in which too many packets are present in a part of the subnet or contending for same kind of link. So the queue overflow, packets gets dropped, network is congested. So if you try to see, these are the subnet where the router is being shown, and these are the buffers. Every buffers will try to send their packets out of it. So when number of buffers, when it tries to move the stored packets to the router, which is a subnet, so automatically what will happen, the router capacity automatically will be not sufficient to find these number of buffers to process it. That's why it is being stated that if the load of the network, that is a load of the network means that number of packets sent to the network is greater than the capacity of that network, that is a number of packets that can be handled. This may handle, let us take a 3 buffer, but if the additional 2 more buffers packet is being put across this one, that is what it means, that the capacity of this network is lesser than the packet sent from this buffer. That if this one is lesser as compared to this one, automatically it will not able to process that packet. Thereby you can see a red color that is on this line indicates that the congestion is being held. So as per the congestion situation, one thing is that either the queue may be overflow, that means this may be overflow. You think like a bucket, or that is what the router is. The queue may be overflow. In the queue, the number of packets are there. So these packets will be overflowing. So when the packet is overflowing, what will happen? The packet will drop down. So those packets will not able to send to the destinations. So and moreover, the congestion, the bandwidth will be fully utilized. And if the packet is more than the bandwidth, then the congestions will lead to a entire network under the standstill conditions. So that is what here the congestions it means for your understanding. Let us see this congestion control. The congestions is basically a state occurring in a network layer when the message traffic is so heavy that it will slow down the network response time. So the congestion control refers to the technique and the mechanisms that can either able to prevent before it happens, or it can able to remove congestions after it happens. So there are 2 way we can do this congestion control. One way is that before it happens we can do, or the another way is that after it happens we can control the congestions. So here are the flow diagram. It is being shown with respect to this congestion control. So if you try to see, the congestion control is categorized into 2 part: one, open loop and a closed loop. Now when we talk about a open loop, as you have seen in my previous video series, open loop means a protocols that will prevent or avoid a congestions, ensuring that a system never enter into a congestion state or a congested state. That means a protocol is taking a necessary step to prevent. You can take like this one. You can take the congested is like you are writing an exam. So there are two ways the congestion is there. One is that you are just preparing without any assessment of your preparations time to time. So what will happen at the point of your exam time, you will be finding that if the questions comes in a different pattern, you will be not able to answer it. Then in that case, you get a panic. So that is a congested state. On the other hand, you do a way in which you study a particular module, and after that you do a evaluations of that one by means of a assignment or a quiz or a test. So thereby you are thorough about that module. So when you like that, when you do and when you appear for the any exam, you can able to handle that questions whichever format it appears. So that is what we try to say, that the second type, that even if a problem is there, you can able to solve that problem. So in the open loop system, the protocol try to prevent or avoid the congestions. Ensuring that the systems never enter into congested state. Whereas closed system is that one in which the system enter into congested state, then it will try to detect it. When the system enter into a congested state, it will try to detect it and then it will try to remove it. So that is known as a closed loop. So that is what is being shown. So under the open loop, you are having a different set of categories: retransmission policies, window policies, acknowledgement policies, discarding policies, admission policies. So these are the open loop control systems, congestion control system. Now let's in the closed congestion control systems, it is a back pressure, choke packet, implicit signaling and explicit signaling. So let's take a brief study about these congestions control, how it appears and how it looks like. So we start with the open loop congestion control, where you can try to see that in the open loop congestion control, the policies are applied to prevent the congestions before it happens. So that is very important for you to understand, that before any congestions occurs, the system will try to see that how it can able to prevent it. So this is a passive type of a congestions, because in the passive form of a congestions, they will not able to handle the situation. So this is a passive type. Whereas in the case of closed congestion systems, it can able to detect and remove. So that is a active type. So these two things you have to keep it in your mind. So in the retransmission policies, what it happens in the retransmission, it is something like unavoidable situations. If a sender sends the packet and assume that it is lost or gets corrupted, then the packet it will try to retransmit. So retransmissions, what will happen, you have to repeat that particular process. So in that case, it will increase the congestions in the network. However, a good retransmission policies, it can prevent the congestions, but the retransmission policies, there what you are going to do, you will use a retransmission timer. You try to recall how we have discussed the handshaking or in the windowing methods. When the retransmission take place, we use a timer there. So the timer can optimize the efficiencies to prevent this type of a congestions. So for example, the retransmission policies in the case of TCP is basically used to prevent or alleviate congestions. That means it will try to improve the congestions conditions. So that is what we try to see in the case of a retransmission policies. Another is window policies. Now, in the type of a window policies, the sender may also affects the congestions. So here we are we will be using a selective repeat windows, and based on that selective repeat window or go back end window. So those are the different methods by means of which this congestion control can be made. If you are going with a go back end window, then after a given time, there will be a timer. After the given time, if the packet is not receiving an acknowledge, then a packet is resent. So under this particular situations, the packet will be sending in a safe route, so that it will be it will able to reach at the receiver in a in a safe and sound way. And also the duplications, in case of a duplications in the windowing policies or the repetitions of this type of packets, it will try to create a congestion. So that's why apart from the go back end window, the best the better one is the selective repeat window. The selective repeat window it tries to specify the packet that has been lost. So based on the segment number or based on the identifications of the previous packet that has been sent, and based on that the acknowledgement will be sending, so that the sender will know when and how to decide the which packet data was missing. Third is the acknowledgement policies. Acknowledgement policies means it will also try to improve the receiver so that after so that any affected congestions conditions, it will be determining based on that, and the packet will be resent with respect to the reference of the acknowledgement. Now assume that if a congestion need to control, the another policy is that you delay that particular congestion, so that the sender will also slow down to send the packets whenever the traffic is congested or the network is congested. So this will also prevent the congestions. The another approach is that the receiver may send the acknowledged packet if it is if it has a packet to send at a special timer, and that means after a special a timer expiry times. So in that case the receiver may try to acknowledge only the actual packet at a time, and acknowledgement where acknowledgement will try to reduce the load of the network by sending by making the sender to send the fewer thereby sender will able to send the lesser packets based on the delay in the acknowledgement. So in the acknowledgement policy, the receiver may either do a delay in sending the acknowledgement, or the sender may do a delay in sending the packets. So these are the acknowledgement policies. Now the discarding policies. A discarding policies one comes when the buffer is or the router is not able to process the entire packet because of the congestion. So under that case, it need to maintain the integrity of the transmissions data. Say for example, in the audio transmission, the discard of the sensitive packet should be less as compared to the video. So that is what the quality of the sound will be still preserved, or the clarity of the video frames will be still maintained. Thereby the congestions can also be prevented or alleviated. So that is what we try to see in the case of the discarding policy. We should not go for a heavy discard, but we should try to see that discard should not affect the quality of the application that is being processed. Admission policies. Now, in the case of admission policies, what we try to see is that the quality of service that need to follow. So in this case also the congestions can be prevented based on the virtual circuit network. So in this case switches first will allow the flow the requirement of the flow so that a packet can be admitted to the network, and the router can deny the virtual circuit if there is a congestion in the network and if there is a possibility of a future congestions. So this admission policy over the virtual networking using a router can able to decide when to accept, when not to send, and when the amount of network traffic can be increased. All these things based on the router's future traffic congestions conditions. So these are the categories related to the admissions congestion control under the open loop conditions, where you can see the retransmission of the data, where we that is one part is that we should retransmit the packet in such a way that it should not make the particular network to get congested. The second type is that we should send the duplication of the we should try to see that there should not be a duplication of the packet, and try to see that a specific packet which is sent that should based on the time based. The third is the acknowledgement. We should try to see that there should be a delay in sending the acknowledgement if the packet is not received, so that during the time of the congestions, the sender will also not send based on the received packet. So if a lesser acknowledgement is sent, so that will impose a lesser load. Third is discarding policies. You should try to see that which packet you should be able to discard, and based on that the application should not get affected. Fifth one is that is the admission policy is based on the flow. The router should use a virtual connection to decide based on the conditions of the network when to process that packet for receiving and forwarding. So these are nothing a class which comes under the open loop control system. Now we go to the next is a closed loop control system. Now in the closed loop control system the very first one is a back pressure. What is meant by back pressure? That means assume that through a pipe water is coming. So the moment you put your finger on the top of on the head of that pipe, what happens? Automatically there will be a pressure in that flow of water, and the water will be projected, the projectile motions of that particular water will be longer distance. What it gives a idea is that the moment you put a thumb, then there is a pressure inside that pipe. So that is a back pressure. So this is what we can try to see. Here is a sender. So before that, a closed loop. So closed loop mechanisms, what it try to do, it removes the congestions. That is the first part is there. And there are several different protocols is there that will try to do the control also. So congestions control removal and as well as prevention, everything is coming under the closed loop. Now in the back pressure technique here, this is applied only on the virtual circuit network, because in the virtual circuit every node will know what is the upstream of the node. So this is a source, this is a destination. So in this case the upstream of the node is known so that every node knows which direction the data is flowing and from where it is the data is coming. So here from this source the data is coming to this router one or a node one, it then goes to node one, then it goes to node two, like that, three, four, and then to the destination. And this reverse is indicating it shows that a back pressure. So here a back pressure is a node to node congestions. So this back pressure of this arrow is indicate that this to this node congestions. and it will be in the opposite direction of the data flow. So that you have to remember, it is in the opposite directions. So these opposite directions, it will work. So this technique of a back pressure, it refers to the congestion control mechanism, in which the congested node stop receiving the data from the intermediate upstream nodes. So these are nothing but intermediate nodes. So these, if here this is a congestion node, so this congestion node will prevent not to receive data from the upstream, and this may cause the upstream node and a node to become more congested. That means this is a intermediate nodes. So intermediate upstream node. So if this is congested, so if it is giving a back pressure, so this is getting congested. So this, if this is giving back pressure, this is getting congested. If this is getting back pressure, then this will send and give a back pressure to the sender. So this is why in this method, what happened in the congestion control, congestion nodes will try to stop receiving data from the upstream. So this may cause the upstreams or the node to become more congested. That is the previous node to become more congested. So that is what we see here, and in this in turn will reject certain data from the upstream nodes. So this will, if more congestion, then it will remove that particular data, or the packet will be getting dropped here in this case. So this dropped packet, what will happen, like that one, every others will be also doing the same packet drop. So the packet drop of the congested nodes, how it is doing, it will be reflecting on the node 1, node 2, node 1, and to the source. This is what we see in the case of the back pressures. Now as per the figure, the node 3, more input data it can handle, but once it start dropping the packet from its buffer, that will inform the node 2 to slow down. When the node 2 buffer is overfilled and it is spilling out, then it will give a congestion information. Thereby, the previous node will be, that is node 1, will slow down its packet delivery to the node 2, and thereby this will also put under the congestions. And node 1 will inform the source node to slow down the process. So that will happen. So this will this time it will alleviates the congestions. So the pressure of a node 3 is moved in the backward. So this is what we try to see in the case of a back pressure. That means pressure of a node 3 is moves to node 2, and like that node 1 to the source to remove the congestions. So this is coming under the class of the closed loop congestion control. Now we see the next is the choke pressure. Choke pressure's technique is again a closed loop control technique, and this is also applied for the virtual circuit under the datagram subnets. Here all this router which is being shown in this case of a subnet, this is a router, this is a router, router, router. So source to destination is being shown, just like the previous figure. Here the congestion is taken place here. So in place of this one, this congestion packet, that is a choke packet, is being shown here. So a choke packet is a packet that sends the informations from that node to the source, and to inform that there is a congestion. That means in this case a back pressure was following, but in this case directly the information is going to the origin stations, that is a source. And in the back pressures, the warning, as we in the previous case, we see from a node to node in the that is a upstream node is being informed. So eventually it will reach to the source stations. But here in the choke methods, the warning from the router is encountered, which has encountered the congestions, it will be informed to the source station directly. So you no need to go through the intermediate node. So the intermediate node through will be not warmed. So this type of a control is coming under the ICMP protocols, and and when this type of a router is there in the internet datagram subnets, then it will try to discard certain amount of packets so that the source host will try to quench based on the ICMP, so thereby the control message will able to move further. So this type of warning goes directly from the source to the intermediate node, and thereby it will try to control control its process. So here there is no back pressures conditions. So the this is an example of the condition of the choke node. Now here what will happen when this back pressure is informed to the source node? Source node will try to send the packet by controlling the destination's node by a 50%. Say this is delivering 100% packets, and this has to receive 100 packets, 100% packets. But because of the congestion, it is not making the traffic to slow down. Then immediately source will try to curtail this traffic problem to the destinations by reducing the requirement, that is by 50%, assume. So what will happen? The because of 50%, this 100% delivery will be accordingly reduced. So this will alleviate the durations based on the time interval. So and this choke packet will curtail down the traffic by 50%, by 25%, like that, based on the choke packet's informations, the source will try to take a decision of the destination packet, how much it has to reduce, thereby the congestions can be controlled. Now, the other a type of controlling what we try to put across here is nothing but the implicit signaling. Implicit signaling we have seen earlier is that in the implicit approach, source itself act as a proactive. That is what source itself as a act as a proactive way and try to deduce the existence of the congestions in the network. So that is known as implicit. So there is no communications between the congestion nodes and the source. Source guesses that the congestion in the network and from the feedback that has received, and based on that, the source will try to send the packets. Thereby the congestion acknowledgement. If it is delayed, or accordingly the source will try to delay the flow of the packets from the source end to the destination end. Or you can say the delay in receiving the acknowledgement is intercepted as a congestion of the network by the source. Accordingly, the source will try to slow down. If there is a delay, then source will slow down its. So it will assume that because of congestions, it is. Let me slow down so that the acknowledged packet can be reached in a given time. So that means it is based on the source control. So that is a implicit form of a controlling. The another form of a controlling which we try to see is explicit signaling. Explicit signaling, here the packets are sent back to the source and curtailed down the congestions. So that is not as a special packet is being sent to the source. So as per the node experience in the case of explicit conditions, it will send to the source or the destinations. That is explicit signal methods. That means a choke packet is being sent. So in this choke packet method, a separate packet is being used for this purpose. So in the explicit signaling method, signal will include the packet that carries the data, and explicit signaling in the frame relay conjunction method can either can force either a forward or a backward direction. So in both direction the explicit control will be there. That means either the source switch should be able to reduce or the destination packet should be able to process in a faster basis. That's how the choke packet will see the explicit controlling. Whereas in the implicit case, the source itself act as a proactive. So that is how from the source side it will decide in the case of a implicit conditions. So that's why you find the difference between the implicit conditions and explicit is that in the explicit you will find a information from the conjunction node. But in the case of implicit conditions, based on the delay in receiving, source itself will act as a decisions how to reduce the control packet flow, thereby it will able to control. So explicit conditions, it follows based on the choke packet methods. So here there are two types, is that backward signaling as well as the forward signaling. Backward signaling means a bit can be sent moving in a direction opposite to the conjunctions. That is what? Opposite to the conjunction. And this bit can warn the source that there is a conjunction and that need to slow down or to avoid the discarding of the packets. So that is an overflow of the packets. Whereas in the forward signaling methods, a bit can send the packet moving in a directions of the congestion, that means in this directions of the congestion, and bit can warn the destinations. So this is a forward signaling. So after this congestion again it is happening, so here this warning is going to the destinations, and the receiver in this case will take a policies to slow down the acknowledgement. So when it will slow down the acknowledgement, what will happen? The source will understand that it is after a certain time that if it is based on the policies. So in that conditions, what will happen? It will able to decide based on the selective repeat window, and then automatically because of the delay it will not able to send the packet. So there will the congestion can able to improve or it or that means it will alleviate the congestions under the case of the forward signaling. Backward signaling is one type and forward signaling is another type. The backward signaling, the source will try to control, and here forward signaling, the destination nodes will be able to delay in slowing down the acknowledgement so that the packet forwarding will not take place. So this is how we have seen the different policies of a congestion control under the open loop conditions and the closed loop condition. So these are the important component related to the congestions control that we have come across. So with this we stop here. Thank you.